Thank you. I think this is on. Yeah. Thank you, President Schlissel, and everybody for coming. I'll have a few things to say about Peter Franken during this talk. I didn't know him well. I actually didn't know him hardly at all. I was a graduate student here when he came to visit. He's quite a remarkable guy, and one of the remarkable things about him is he was quite funny. So my thesis advisor, Mike Sanders, would 1 year held the or hosted the physics colloquia, and every speaker, President Schlissel, you'll have to forgive me, every speaker he introduced, he would promptly go to sleep in the front row right after he introduced them. And of course, all of us graduate students sort of enjoyed that, but it was, I think, Peter Franken, this was the 1970s, who said when he saw this, "Mike, I don't mind if you look at your watch to see what time it is, but I do mind if you put it to your ear to hear if it's still ticking." So that was Peter Franken, and I'll have a little bit more to say. Today I want to talk to you about a topic I'm really passionate about, and that's the emission of light, and particularly its use in organic light-emitting devices. And the way I'm going to structure this talk is I'm going to spend a very brief amount of time just informing you of what organic materials are as semiconductors, and then I'm going to launch into a little history and how I got into this field and how other people really made some magnificent innovations and discoveries that led to what we now know as a huge global industry. And then I'm going to talk, because I want to reach everybody in this crowd, I'm going to talk right at the end about the way in my laboratory we solve a very important problem in organic LEDs. So for all of you people who didn't take undergraduate organic chemistry, and even for those who did, but time has marched on, let me just remind you what organic materials are. They are basically carbon-rich compounds, and they come in three varieties from an electronic perspective. Monomers, which are single units. Again, if you go back to your organic chemistry world, these stick diagrams, basically there's a carbon atom at every vertex, and if it's an outer vertex, there's also a hydrogen atom sitting there. And these monomers are well-defined structures. It's only a couple nanometers in diameter. And we find them everywhere. They're ubiquitous. Everybody in this room is probably wearing monomers on their clothing. They're dye compounds. They're found in your on your inkjet printouts and so on and so forth. And of course, they're also used in paints everywhere. My favorite is this monomer, which I'll talk about a little bit here, is PTCDA. This is just a model of a unit cell or just a few molecules of this stuff. Again, they're only a couple nanometers across. This stuff is used as a primary pigment in car paint. And it, in its own way, has revolutionized the world of organic semiconductors. Now, if you string a lot of these monomers along in a chain, you get polymers. And polymers we know as plastics, but they also tend to be pretty good electronic materials. And finally, because people confuse organic materials with biological materials, that's not actually a confusion. It's just biological materials come from a biological origin, although many of these others do too. Biological molecules actually have good electronic properties at times too. Photosynthetic complexes in plants, for example, are really good electron generators. They're antennas, they take in the sun, very much like we make organic solar cells. So plants, animals, and a subclass of animals is us. I'm not going to talk about biological molecules at all here. Mostly I'm going to talk about monomers, which is the stuff we do. So let me now go toward a very brief history of organic electronics. And you can take organic electronics back to, that is using organic materials as I've shown in the previous view graph for electronic purposes. You can probably take it back to the 1910s, 1920s. But I'm going to start my chart in 1950 by a work by Inokuchi, who is, I believe, the father of organic electronics. At the just in the post-war era at the University of Tokyo, he found that this particular molecule, just a bunch of carbons and a couple oxygens and hydrogens, had this. This is the log of the resistivity. Well, this isn't going to work, so I'll just point. I'll hand wave, which is what I do best anyway. On the vertical axis is the resistivity, and on the horizontal axis is 1 over the temperature. So high temperature is in the corner, and the resistivity increases with the log of the temperature, or as 1 over the temperature. And that tells you that this is a semiconductor. A semiconductor, of course, is all the electronic components that we have in all of our machines that are running our lives today. Silicon is the dominant semiconductor. So this, to me, was really the beginning of the field. And I think all of Japan, and certainly myself and many others, felt that this was very much worthy of a Nobel Prize. Then, well, we're going to be talking about light today. The first time there was the observation of light coming from an electrically excited organic material. This was done by Helfrich. It actually was not done by Helfrich and Schneider. It's, I don't want to get into the detail, but in 1963, something else happened by Martin Pope. But in 1965, they put electrodes on anthracene. Now, anthracene is an organic molecule. It's shown there. It's three fused benzene rings. And it is one of the components of anthracite coal, which is why it's called anthracene. And it was the subject of intense investigation in Germany. But these guys put some electrodes on a chunk of this stuff and got blue light out. Unfortunately, that blue light came out at 100 to 1,000 volts. So while it was fairly efficient, that is, they got a lot of electrons to create photons, it took a lot of voltage, and that was not going to go into anybody's piece of electronic gear. Of course, in those days, it was all vacuum tubes, so voltage was not a problem. But that was not where these, this was a point of discovery. And I do want to break my timeline now into two parts. So something very big happened in the mid-1980s, which really set a whole different spin on the ball here. So before this 1985 time frame, I would call that the age of organic science and discovery. Almost everything that came out was fundamental in nature. People were just discovering how these really miraculous materials, very colorful, were behaving as electronic materials. And then from the mid-80s on to today, we're in the what I call the age of organic electronics. Now, somewhere in the mid-70s, Alan Heeger and his colleagues at the University of Pennsylvania, McDermid and Shirakawa, learned how to dope a polymer, very much like you dope silicon to make a useful device. And they doped a polymer, and they won the Nobel Prize for it many years later in the year 2000. But that was the time when our field was really recognized as maybe something that people should be involved in. That time, this young guy at Bell Labs ran into two crazy characters down the hall. And that was me running into Marty Kaplan, a chemist, and Paul Schmidt, a metallurgist. And they said, Steve, we got this stuff. Marty thinks that this molecule that you see here, which you just saw in an Aldrich catalog because it's car paint, this stuff ought to turn into a polymer like Heeger did if all we did was put it in an oven and make it, they pyrolyzed it. And I look at this stuff they gave me, it's all black, and I says, they say, here, take this ohmmeter, put it on here and see if it's a conductor. I didn't even look at it, look at the ohmmeter. I says, of course it's a conductor, you've burnt it. It's just carbon. So I said, before I can do that, I want to know what this stuff is before you do that. So they brought me another sample completely by chance. Paul had an enormous drawer filled with just substrates of all kinds of materials. He just put it down on silicon, and he brought it into my lab. And he says, here, it's on silicon. I can't use this stuff. I don't know with the silicon. He says, just measure it. And we measured it, and we came up with something that was startling, a junction diode. We just put a layer of this stuff on top of silicon, put a contact on top, and what you see in these kind of black and white photographs are curve trace images where we have current on the vertical axis and voltage on the horizontal axis, and we made a beautiful junction diode at a time when nobody could make a junction out of, or any useful device, out of an organic. All right, so it was part silicon, but the thing that was really doing the work was the PTCDA. So this was a startling discovery. It turns out that when you pyrolyze PTCDA, it turns into a polymer. Who knew? So that was true. And we just went on working. But I have to tell you that after Heger came through and talked about his conducting polymers, all of Bell Labs got really excited about organic electronics until they found out that this stuff dies right in front of you. So that was 1977, 78. And so an edict came down from the president of Bell Labs, thou shalt not work on organic materials for electronic applications, or thou shalt be fired. This was not good news for Paul and Marty and me, so we did our day jobs, and then at night I would work on this stuff. And then I had to, of course, we wanted to publish papers, so I went to my boss and I said, his name is Barney DeLoach, and I said, Barney, I need to publish this stuff. It's good stuff. He says, you can't do it. They'll fire you. I says, it's okay. We wash it off after it's done. He says, all right, in that case, well, you can publish it. And so that got us going. And of course, what I like to tell my students, the moral of this story is, don't listen to your boss. Unless, of course, the boss is me. So this material is a remarkable semiconductor, and it is still heavily investigated today. It has so many interesting properties that it's really the what people have termed the Drosophila of the organic materials world. So that has been a lot of fun, and it still pops up in my lab all the time, and it's used in your Chevy for red car paint. So here was where the world flipped, and that was the invention of an efficient OLED. And I put efficient in double quotes. Two guys at Kodak, Ching Tang, a chemist, and Steve Van Slyke, an engineer, took all of their massive chemical inventory. Kodak was, in the end, a chemical company. They took two rather typical xerographic photographic dye compounds, ALQ and TPD, and they contacted them, put them between, basically it's only 100 nanometers thick, it's very thin, put it between two contacts, a transparent indium tin oxide, ITO, and silver, put electrons through it, and out came green light. And it didn't come out at 1,000 volts or 100 volts, it came out at 5 volts. And the efficiency was 1%. Pretty low, but it got one Japanese company, Pioneer, extremely excited. This may be the next display technology, except it was still rather inefficient. You had to put in 100 electrons to get one photon out. This is another story of not listening to your boss. So Ching tells me, and tells everybody actually, that he actually did this work back in 1980. And they had it, and they had it, and he did it in this little bell jar. And of course, it's a chemical company. So chemical companies never let you publish because everything's top secret. And then his bosses decided the stuff that he was working on was totally useless. So go ahead and publish it. And of course, then Pioneer got involved. Everybody started to think about this. Lots of Japanese, particularly Japanese universities, got involved in this. And Kodak says, maybe this is more important than we thought. I guess the moral of that story is sometimes your bosses, although you shouldn't always listen to them, they're also not as bright as you think they are. So this kind of went along for a while. The next thing is Richard Friend at Cambridge used a polymer to make a light-emitting diode. It was extremely inefficient, but it was still getting light out at low voltage. It was about 0.05% efficient. So this is kind of where this thing was trundling along until 1997-98. And my student, in collaboration with a group at University of Southern California, my closest collaborator really over the years, Mark Thompson, another chemist. I hang out with chemists is kind of the another thing that you're going to get a feeling for here. And what we discovered was that a very simple lesson from quantum mechanics. The Tang device, well, you send in an electron from an electrode, and you send in a hole that is the positively charged counterpart to that, which only semiconductor people have any idea what it means, and some of them don't either. But they're basically two spins. So electrons have this quantum mechanical property called spin. And if you send in these particles randomly, one quarter of them will come out as a singlet state, and three quarters of them come out as a what's called a triplet state. Now, singlets is a quantum mechanically allowed, it undergoes a quantum mechanically allowed transition that allows it to luminesce very intensely and very rapidly, but only 25% of the electrons go into that state. The rest of them, 75%, go into triplet states, and these phosphoresce. So if you have a illuminating dial on your watch, not an electronic watch, but one of these old-fashioned watches, that's phosphorescent. It's basically, you excite all the molecules, and then very, very slowly over the period of the night, they give off very dim, inefficient light, totally useless. But what we did was we inserted a heavy metal atom into the middle of the molecules, iridium, platinum. Our first work was with platinum. Then we went on to the iridium complexes. And you get something which is called spin-orbit coupling, another quantum mechanical effect, which takes all of the singlets and rapidly transfers them to the triplet state. And the triplet state becomes radiative on the order of a microsecond. And so all of a sudden, we had 100% efficient devices. And this really opened the way toward using OLEDs as a lighting source and as a display source. So I'm going to take one brief moment to tell you how we visualize color. We have cones and rods in our eye, and the cones have three color sensitivities, red, green, and blue. Those are the spectra there of the cones. You can actually see cones and rods in that little cellular diagram in the corner that's in the retina. And miraculously, we have a sense that we can quantify with two numbers, which are the color coordinates. So you have a color chart here, which was sort of constructed in the 30s by having 10,000 people look at color cards. And there's a lot of detail here, but the fact of the matter is that your color sense can be quantified into two coordinates, x and y. You take any illumination source, like an OLED, and you find out how its spectrum overlaps with the sensitivity of the rods and cones in the eye. And you can see that it's interesting, the red cone has sensitivity in the blue. And by doing this, you can visualize any color. So we took our molecules and just modified kind of little tiny little subtle things about the molecular structure around the edge. They're all iridium complexes, and we've done this with the platinums, and other people have done it with gold and osmium. Any heavy metal will work, and my friend Mark Thompson is now working with the copper complexes. But these are photographic images of 1 centimeter square OLEDs at all parts of the color spectrum. And they're all about 100% efficient internally. And by mixing those colors, you see On your screen, on your video screen, you see the image that you're looking for in the color tones that you want. You can access with your machine, let's say your color printout or your LCD or whatever it is that you're working with, if your three pixels that make up a full color are, let's say, a red, green, and blue, you just make a triangle and you can visualize any color within that triangle, and that's called the gamut. So this was exciting. And that was Mark Baldo's thesis, working on spin effects in organics. And then we had a little bit of a bump in the road, but luckily there was now a growing industry. Bell Labs went through an economic collapse because of the crash of the internet bubble, and to try to prop it up, this one postdoc all by himself tried to inflate it with a total fraud, which is now known as the biggest fraud ever in physics. Unfortunately, it was right in the middle of my field. This guy would come, I was at Princeton at the time, he'd come up and talk to my students. They said, this guy is fantastic. He published every 10 days in Science and Nature for 2 years. We'd go out drinking with this guy till late at night. We'd have bottles all around. And then he'd go back to the lab and he'd measure 3,000 diodes. How did he do that? There's a long story. We had a long interaction with Henrik, who has now disappeared from the scene. But it really did if a field isn't robust, that would have killed it. But this one didn't kill it because the field was going somewhere. And then in the beginning of this decade, Samsung committed to making phones, and then LG. So let me talk about displays. Why are OLED displays so great? And sometimes my wife, Roz, who's sitting here in the audience, thinks that I work for Samsung because I talk with such glowing terms and always want people to buy Samsung phones and things. This is a liquid crystal display on top. I'm not going to go into any of the detail. And there's an OLED display on the bottom. And the one thing you'll see is there's a lot less layers. With an OLED display, you have the emitting layer, you have a polarizer, and you have a glass substrate. That's it. With an LCD, you need a backlight. It's a fluorescent tube. It looks ugly. Then you have all of these. You have cross polarizers. You have two polarizers. You have a color filtering sheet, and so on. So you get about a 5% efficiency. It's pretty thick. And with OLEDs, you get it something to 30 to 40% efficiency. This just shows a microscopic image of the display showing the red, green, and blue pixels that combine to make colors at each location. So you get very true blacks, very efficient. It's very simple, it's thin, and it's flexible. And for those of you who really want to see these things in action, I've got an Apple iPad and a Samsung. So that's an LCD and a Samsung pad up here, tablet. And you can, if you don't see the difference, then you have to go and have some more wine at the reception. This is what's happened. And these are all phosphorescent displays with one exception, and I'll talk about that. In terms of the color matching of them. But this in the upper left shows the growth of the industry. It's actually almost accurate because it's a projection, but the projection has been working. I've been using this view graph for a couple of years. So in 2016, it was about close to a $20 billion industry. The entire LCD display industry is $120 billion. So in a matter of 4 or 5 years, it's gobbled up about 15% of that industry. Today, 2/3 of the phones made are OLED phones. Galaxy is the first runner. If you have a Galaxy 7, you should leave the room immediately and put it in a bucket of water. This is what I call my McDonald's view graph because it says 1.5 billion sold. I think there's many more than, nobody knows how to count these things anymore. And then LG came out with TVs. And they came out with TVs. So I have a 55-inch old-style LG TV in my physics office. They're only about this thick. They're absolutely gorgeous. Now they're making them so thin that they hold 77-inch OLED displays up on walls with magnets. They call them, I think, video wallpaper. Panasonic, Sony, and Toshiba are coming out with TVs in the 66 to 77-inch range this year. Most of them are all made by, all these displays are either made by Samsung or LG, but there are other manufacturers getting into the mix. To make one of these cell phones takes a machine that is longer than the big house. 120 meters long is what an OLED manufacturing machine looks like, and you have a couple of them in a row. And of course, I travel a lot, particularly to Asia. So I went to, just before Christmas, I went to Korea. And LG is really making a big play. They have this is at Incheon International Airport. And they have this gigantic display. They even have like these Kodak spots where you're supposed to stand so you can take a selfie of yourself in the display. This is a semicircle, so it's the same size on the other side. And you can see the size of the people underneath. So this gets kind of exciting for geeks like me. Just one other thing, electricity. This is efficient stuff, right? I mean, we got 100% internal efficiency. We still got to get the light out of the darn thing. But we do have the capability of generating huge amounts of light for very little investment of electricity. This shows the residential uses of electricity. This is just residential. And you can see that 10% goes to lighting, but 17% goes to air conditioning. Most lighting today remains incandescent, which is extremely inefficient, about 5% efficient. It's basically a heater, which gives off light as a byproduct. So we'd rather have lighting appliances that give off light and very little heat. So there's a huge benefit to making efficient lighting. And it's just the tip of the iceberg, because there's a lot of electricity used in lighting in plants and outdoors and everything and everywhere else. To give a lighting comparison, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. This just shows the two contenders today. And you find LEDs in Home Depot. You can't find incandescents anymore because they're slowly being eliminated due to act of Congress. But the efficiency of incandescents is 17 lumens per watt. Lumens is just a visual sense of brightness. The more lumens, the brighter. OLEDs are up in the labs at about 150 lumens per watt. LEDs about the same. And the big problem why you don't see OLEDs in the market right now is it costs about $100 per kilolumen. It's competing against incandescents, which is, well, it's very cheap. But compact fluorescence, these things wander all, it depends on the quality of the bulb. $3, LEDs are about $4.50 per kilolumen. So that's where everything's going right now. But OLEDs are, they just need to get manufactured. There's a large discussion out there. Will OLEDs ever find a place? LED people don't want OLEDs to find a place because then they have to share government money for it, for its development. So we've decided with our friends at Universal Display Corporation to come up with the perfect application where both are needed. This is how I get to work every morning when I'm not walking. So you can see that OLEDs are a nice area lighting type of thing. And those points around the blue things are specular lights, which are LEDs. But this is what's being made with OLED lighting. A chandelier at Deutsche Bank on the left, other stuff from Acuity Lighting. You can make transparent windows and so on. And you can fold them and flex them. This was 2 years ago at the Computer Electronics Show. LG had a 55-inch flexible OLED device, flexible TV. And the most conservative electronics company on the planet, Apple, has dipped their toe in the water with these iWatches, but the rumor has it that the iPhone 8 will be an OLED phone, and that will mean that basically 100% of all phones made in the future and tablets will be OLED. And virtual reality is really enabled. I was going to bring virtual reality glasses. I was in China, and I was talking to Ching Tang, and he was always telling me how he got free TVs from this guy and from that guy. And I said, Ching, why don't I get these things? He says, because you're not as nice as I am. So, which is probably true. So I went and up to these guys at a booth, and I was really nice, and they said they'd send me some fantastic OLED, virtual reality OLED glasses. That hasn't come. So I have to keep working on my personality traits. At any rate, we can roll this stuff out by the mile. That's the idea, is we can make it flexible. We can roll it up so that we don't need a screen like this anymore. That can be an OLED display. So this is all well and good. It looks great. Why am I hanging around and still working on OLEDs? There's a lot more to be done. And I want to talk about one problem that we have focused on in the next few minutes that I have to talk about some really significant problems that remain and how we go about them. So there's big picture issues like the importance of materials. And as I've already said, I work very closely with chemists, particularly Mark Thompson. And I've also talked about the fact that Friend did a polymer OLED, and there's been a lot of work on that. But everything out there, all the applications are in small molecules because you can purify them and manipulate the structure of the devices to get very high efficiency. So I think that ship has sort of left the dock, and it's going to be small molecule. Blue lifetime is still a problem, and that's what I'm going to talk about the rest of the time. Getting the light out, cost and yield. Those are all big problems, and actually we're working on all of them in my lab. So let me just dip in here a little bit into what I call tech heaven. In every one of these displays, the phosphorescence, which is really high efficiency, all the red and green pixels are phosphorescence. But unfortunately, the blue pixel is fluorescent. And the reason is that the triplet emitting molecules in the blue die very quickly, in the matter of hours. So you can't, the blue pixel on these displays is dying fairly fast. But this is a very high value problem if we can fix it, if we can bring phosphorescence into all three pixel colors. And it's good for white, it's good for although there are ways of still making a 100% efficient device in the white with a blue fluorescent medium. But this just shows you what energy you save in your display, for example, if you add a red plus a green plus a blue phosphorescent pixel on it, and you get up to 74% improvement over what you would get with a fluorescent blue. So we think in my lab that blue is very beautiful. This is very interesting work by a student who's just graduated. I think he is number 55. Oh, 56, I'm told. All right. It's like watching the stock market. So he took a molecule that was exactly the same composition, but just very slightly different spatially. So it was two isomers of the same molecule. And in one, he could make it deep blue. And in another device with this other form of the molecule, it was a little greener. They're so intense that we have to point the devices away from the viewer, otherwise it just looks white. And he's just got it cast on a piece of paper. So the actual device is a tiny little thing. You can just kind of see the two little white bars on the edge. Most of the pixel is going backwards. These were extremely efficient, very bright, truly exciting work, but they die like everything else. We thought we had the key to long life, but we didn't. So I want to talk a little bit about, this is really the culmination of about 8 years of work in my lab. In 2000, Russ Holmes and Chahia Dachi were the first to demonstrate a blue phosphorescent OLED, and ever since then they've been dying like crazy, and people all over the world are working on making better materials all the time. And I had another student, Chris Giebink, who decided to look at this from a more fundamental point of view. Maybe it's not just about chemistry. So we of course, observed that the lifetime of a red OLED is longer than a green, is longer than a blue. So the implication is that device death is energy driven. If you just look at the red light, the green light, and the blue light, the photon energy scales with those colors. And so now you go through, here's a typical chemical that we use in our devices, and you look at all the bond strengths, carbon-carbon, carbon-hydrogen. This only has carbon, nitrogen, and hydrogen in it. And I've got 2.9 volts out there to kill this thing, let's say to blow up a bond, to destroy the molecule. I don't have any bond there that wouldn't be delighted to host 2.9 electron volts, because they're strong enough. So there doesn't seem to be enough energy around to destroy the molecule, or is there? So this was the Giebink model. And these are what are called Jablonski diagrams. It's basically energy on the vertical axis and atomic position within the molecules. On the horizontal axis, you have one molecule that has an excited state, so that's called an S1 or a T1. It collides with an excited state on the nearby molecule, and you get double the energy. So it turns out the triplet energy in the blue is 2.9 volts. The charge carrier has about 3.3 volts. Now I've got plenty of energy to kill my molecules. And that's what's happening very fast in these devices. That's called a dissociative state. So Yifan Shang, in my group, decided he's going to believe what Chris Giebink did, and he's going to make a device that takes advantage of it. And what he did, I don't want to go into the details, but in these nanometer thick layers, we have a dopant, that is the blue phosphorescent material, which carries holes, and we have a host material which carries electrons. Those two things meet, and they form this excited state. So let's just get the density of excited states down. It turns out in a conventional OLED, they all pile up at one end of the emission region. In our device, Yifan decreased the doping as a function of distance across this very narrow region and spread out the exciton density. If Giebink's right, these things ought to live longer. And they live a lot longer. So he got 10 times the lifetime. This just shows kind of the decay of their light output as a function of time. For his graded device, then we stacked a couple devices to make a graded device. And he got a 10x improvement in the lifetime of blues. This is literally the first significant increase in blue full LED lifetime since their invention. But it's still not good enough. We still have all that energy running around in there. So I'll show you one last thing, and then I'll be done. So we showed that we could spread out the region, but you can't spread it out forever. So we're just about as done as we're going to be done. That's a 10x. Can we just get rid of that energy before it kills the molecules? So here is that old Jablonski diagram. And what happens, so this is energy on the vertical scale. This is a molecule. Don't worry about the fact that these things have shape. They're just molecular potentials. So you can see that there's some charges or electrons in that first excited state. The ground state where everything collapses to give off light is S0. The active blue emitting state is T1. So what we want to have happen is one electron to fall from the excited state to the ground state and give off a blue photon. That's when life is good. Okay, but unfortunately, as I said, they kind of clang into each other. And instead of doing that, we get what's called an Auger process, where one goes down to the ground state without giving off light, kicking another one up to this really high energy state, something like 6 or 7 electron volts. And this kind of curved line is what's called the dissociative or pre-dissociative state. If that excited state doesn't come back down right quick, it's going to blow up the molecule. That's what that means. So it dissociates the thing. And so it can do this, which is OK, and we get our photon back out. Or it can do this, and we get a dead molecule. That's what's happening. So we thought, why can't we completely kill that route of loss? We want to get rid of that D route. So we put in a new molecule, which we call a manager molecule. Its energy sits kind of midway between that desired state and the really hot one up on top. Now what happens is that hot state can go over to the manager molecule, go back down there, and we get our blue photon out again. And there was no damage to our molecule. Life isn't always perfect. So it could also, let's see what happens. There we go. The manager molecule can explode. This can happen, but we don't care because it's not giving off any light. So we came up with this idea, and then we figured out what we needed to do with a manager. It had to have an energy intermediate between that blue emitting state and the hot one that was the damaging state. It's got to be stable, and there's got to be a very fast, those green lines have to be very fast. They have to happen before the molecule dissociates. We found our molecules. I won't go into the details. Very careful study. This just looks at the emission layer, which we call the EML. We've chosen some manager molecules. Mark is always sending us molecules. I think these were sitting on the shelf. And Jay Song Lee decided maybe I'll try those. They were nice and blue. And so he doped the EML with a manager. And then he decided, well, maybe if I just put the manager in different places in the EML, those are 10 nanometer wide bins. The whole emission zone is only 50 nanometers wide. What happens when we do that? And the effect is immediate. So this is a plot of the exciton density as a function of position across the EML. And when we put the manager in different locations, we get a longer lifetime. So now we're up to, a factor of 3 here, a factor of 10 there. Before you know it, you have an OLED that you can put in a machine. But we're getting there. We've now seen 30 times improvement. Still not good enough. But this is a whole new approach, and it gives the chemists out there a whole new collection of molecular strategies for now solving the lifetime problem. And of course, our friends in Korea, which is the dominant country in this field, are starting to think about coming up with molecular sets for managers. But this is a totally new idea that could probably go well beyond OLEDs and into all kinds of organic electronic devices where you need to be siphoning off energy. So will OLEDs dominate displays and lighting? I think I've already told you they're dominating in mobile applications, completely dominant now. And LCDs will be gone in a few years. TVs may be a little longer, but LG is doing a spectacular job of solving the cost issues and the performance issues. And you can go into Best Buy and look at these OLED TVs. And I think if you're in the market for a TV, I will take it as a personal slight if you don't buy one. So will they dominate displays and lighting? Well, as I like to tell people, I'm a scientist and I'm an engineer. And the only thing you really need to be successful at science and engineering is optimism. Because you're confronted every day with enormous failure. Every experiment you try is a failure. So if you're not optimistic, thinking that the next one's going to be positive, you stop. So, absolutely. Well, you don't always get success at the end either, so I don't know. Large area, ultra-efficient, color-tunable, architecturally adaptable form factor make this an opportunity too good to miss. So the other thing I like to say is that economics is stronger than physics, and if people want this stuff, others are going to figure out how to make it work for them. But there are great challenges for universities, for industrial laboratories, for people all over the world who are doing stuff from the fundamental and just pure discovery, all the way up to really technologically significant applications. We have really put our stake in the ground to work on blue phosphorescent OLEDs, and we think that we can get to about 100 times lifetime improvement. I don't know exactly what the definition of winning is here in the sense of when will PHOLEDs go into displays, but I suspect when they get to about 6,000-7,000 hours lifetime. And we're really pushing this idea of hot excited state managers. We need to have innovative means for getting the light out. We're working on a lot. That's just a pure optics problem, but an important one. And patterning of large surfaces at low cost is driven primarily by the display industry, these gigantic machines. I've been very lucky because I get to see the laboratories and the machines that people are making to produce these types of widgets, and I get a real appreciation and sort of insights into what the problems are. So with that, I'll show you a rather old picture of my group. Unfortunately, you know, at a university, people come and go. Eventually, we have to graduate people. Postdocs go and find another job somewhere with a better boss. This is my group about a year and a half ago. Jay Song, the guy who's doing the management stuff, is kind of sitting. He's got a big smile on his face. I think at that point he thought he might actually graduate. And then Eva Ruff in the corner, who has been the administrator in my group for many years. We've been funded by Air Force Office of Scientific Research, Department of Energy, and Universal Display Corporation. So thank you very much.
But it was George who was the prover, along with Kenshin, of the ergodic theorem. So he was both involved in probability and in symbolic logic, which was an interesting combination.